All right, let's now talk about how we can use batch norm in practice. And also we will talk briefly about how batch norm behaves during inference, because yeah, you know that during training we have mini batches, but that's not necessarily the case if we want to use our network for prediction. Sometimes we only have a single data point, so how would that work? So, but yeah, first let me show you how batch norm works when we use PyTorch. I've actually just used the code from last week where I implemented dropout and just made a slight modification where I removed dropout and added a batch norm layer. So I was just accept that reusing the same code. So I don't want to walk through this in detail, but you can find the code here on GitHub. And yeah, here I'm showing you the main code, the multilayer perceptron that we have to modify. And yeah, so what we have here is two hidden layers and the output layer at the bottom. And first, notice that I'm using, again, flatten. That's because I was working with MNIST, and MNIST is n times 1 times 28 times 28 dimensional. And flatten will essentially flatten this to a vector, to a n times 784 dimensional vector, where n is the batch size. And then it will work with the fully connected linear layer here. So yeah, I here insert batch norm after the linear layer. Notice that there is a 1D. It may be confusing, why is there a 1D? That's because there is a slightly different version of batch norm for convolutional networks. We will discuss this in the convolutional network lecture, where this would be called batch norm 2D for the convolutional networks. So to keep them apart, this is called batch norm 1D. This is essentially just the batch norm that we discussed here in the previous videos. So the 1D is just to keep them apart. And here I'm doing the same thing in the second hidden layer. Also, yeah, notice that I set the bias to false, because it would be redundant, right? Because if we compute the net input as, let's say, the weight times the feature plus B, and then in batch norm we had this plus beta value, so in that way the bias becomes kind of redundant, so it's not necessary, but you can have it there, it doesn't really matter. I ran it with and without it, and I didn't notice any difference in this case. Okay, so this is how batch norm looks like. The full code example can be found here, but there's really nothing really to talk about, because it's just two lines of code here. So I was also just for fun running some experiments without the bias that I just showed you, and having batch norm before the activation. That's usually how, that was originally how it was proposed in the paper. But sometimes people also, nowadays it's even more common to have it after the activation. I will talk more about that in the next video. I found some benchmarks, some more sophisticated benchmarks I wanted to show you. So, but here in this case, when I ran the code of the multilayer perceptron that I just showed you, I enabled the bias. So I'm actually not showing it here. I don't know why I deleted it, but by default, bias is true if you don't set anything. And I found it was the same performance. I then also inserted batch norm after the activation instead of before the activation, like here or here. So I now, instead of here having it before the activation, I now have it after the activation in both cases. And I also didn't notice any difference really here. And then I also ran experiments with dropout. In this case also I didn't notice much of a difference, except now the network was not overfitting anymore. The test accuracy for both dropout cases was slightly lower compared to no dropout. I think I used just too much dropout, but I could at least see there was no overfitting anymore. But yeah, the comparison here is inserting batch norm before the activation and then dropout, and then after the activation and then dropout. And I also did not notice any difference here. In practice, people nowadays, it's more common to actually recommend, if you use dropout, to recommend having batch norm after the activation. And yeah, one little fun memory aid to remember that is, if you consider this case, so you have batch norm, then you have the activation, and then you have dropout. You may call it bad. It might be better to have batch norm after the activation. That's typically a little bit more common. In this case, I didn't notice any difference. It may make a small difference in other types of networks like convolutional networks. So I would, if you use dropout and batch norm, I would probably go with this variant. But yeah, of course, it's something, it's a hyperparameter essentially to experiment with. All right, so one more thing about dropout in PyTorch. So when we look again at our training function here, this is exactly the same training function that I used last week in dropout. But again, this is again highlighting train and eval are important here, that we during training set our model into training mode, because that's where batch norm will compute the running mean and the running variance. I will talk about this in the next slide. So here, batch norm will actually compute some running statistics during training. And these running statistics are then used in the evaluation mode when we evaluate our model on new data. So during an evaluation, you have to imagine that you are mimicking the inference scenario. And in inference, you may only have a single data point, right? So let's say you have a Google search engine and there's just one user running a query and you have a network that has batch norm. So you have to normalize, but you don't have a batch of users, so only if one user. So how do we deal with that scenario? So there are two ways to deal with that scenario. The easy one would be to use a global training set mean and variance. So you would compute these means for the features and the variances for the features for the whole training set. That's something you would also usually do or could do when you compute the input standardization. But this is actually not very common in practice for some reason. So what's more common is to use an exponentially weighted average, or a moving average. It's just a different name for that. So usually in practice, people keep a moving average of both the mean and the variance during training. So you can think of it as also as the running mean. How it's computed is by having a momentum term. It's usually a small value like 0.1. And this is multiplied by the running mean from the previous previous mini batch. And then you have this this term. This is like the running mean times the momentum term. This is a 0.1 value. And then you have 1 minus the momentum. This is like a 0.9 value. Then plus 0.9 times the current sample mean. So that's the mini batch mean. And you just do the same thing also for the running variance. So here, essentially, this is just like a moving average or a running mean. And you do the same thing for the variance. That's what you keep, and then during inference you use that one to scale the data point that you do a prediction on. You yourself don't have to do that yourself, by the way. By using model eval, it will actually happen automatically. But yeah, here's just like the explanation what's gonna happen under the hood. Okay, so yeah, that is how batch norm works in PyTorch. And in the next video, I want to briefly go over a brief rundown of all the types of literature that try to explain how batch norm works.